Well, aloha guys, you're watching GRTV Hawaii in search of a great marriage, new ideas, and easyworldpeace.com. I'll tell you how easy. By applying all these ideas, we've already got the technology out there, you know, in the world, but by configuring things and communicating, we're going to achieve that peace that we know is possible, you know. I know it's possible. That's why I've devoted myself to it. And, you know, I'm a bit of a monk on a mission, you know, delaying the standard enjoyments of life in order to boost humanity up. And that's what people like me do. By the way, check out the, we got a sleeper on location. We got a sleeper on location. So, I'm going to talk about some conversations I've had recently. Four different conversations. One of them is that there was this, you know, I do have different clients. I do handyman work. I encountered one gay guy, and you know, I worked, and then he made some advances. I just left without being paid, and I want to, and I thought, well, how can I think of, you know, the bigger picture here? And so I ended up explaining to him, by the way, text message and emails often better for formal dialogue. It allows for more carefully crafted answers and responses, and you know, it ensures that people will be at least their distance, they're spaced away. It's not like in person or shouting over the phone if there are heart, you know, feelings to be exchanged. So I told him that, you know, I realized that me being a man, if, you know, if I was around, you know, women I was attracted to, I might, you know, it might be harder for me to avoid doing certain things, like at least whatever, maybe a flirtatious comment or a look or a glance. And not that I would do these things, but especially the scenario, you know, the guy was apparently a guy who, you know, was not concerned. He liked premarital intimacy, and you know, you got to find quick ways to discern whether people like premarital intimacy or not. You know, try to at least establish that so you can be on guard as needed, and try to present to them that, you know, even though you're single, you're committed to yourselves and your future dream mate, you know, bring that up as opportune in work settings, and that'll help protect you, along with, of course, the wedding ring and whatnot, and the willingness to leave on the spot. Collect your things and leave. If there is some type of conflict, be it in my instance, a bit of sexual harassment, and in other instances, different variations of conflict. But so I expressed to him, I told him that, you know, I realize it might be hard, but to avoid somehow acting on your desires, but you know, and under the premise of I'd like to be friends. If I didn't want to be friends and I didn't, you know, care about people, then I would just, you know, dismiss it and not even talk to him. But I want answers. I do care, and I'm interested. Why is this happening? How do we resolve this? Not just for myself, but future situations like this that may come up with other people. So I expressed it. I mean, I want to be friends, but you know, we, you know, you can't, you know, you have to realize that, like, he, you know, he offered me like a drink and whatnot, and you know, people have to realize that when you're in their house or and you're, you know, either doing work or you know, maybe they're your supervisor or whatnot, that they have a degree of authority, and tell them they should not abuse this power, abuse this. We know when you're in somebody's house and you're working, you know, you want to, you know, accommodate them to an extent so that the work can get done and you can get paid. And so, you know, but abusing that power, and then instead of exploding and just, you know, getting angry, I just left quietly and then made an effort to talk about it afterward at some point. And so that's that. And then another conversation I had was you know, a lady actually, and I, you know, she single woman, but and same scenario. I was doing cleaning at her house, and you know, they're even though I don't think she was, you know, interested in me in particular, I had found myself to be aroused by her, and I realized that, you know, maybe it's not a good idea that I be around this person, if possible, because it, you know, it just, I don't like to feel the tension of being aroused. You know, I like to feel good. I like to feel like I don't have to worry about things. I can just do my work, enjoy my work. So you know, you people out there, you know, construction workers, whatever it may be, I feel you have some of the best jobs because you're, you know, just dealing with fellow guys, generally not homo, although I like to work with homo or bi people. I you know, I care about people, but we have to exercise a layer of precaution. And maybe the more masculine homo guys, you know, the husband, quote unquote, would work construction or whatever job it is. But the point is being in an environment where you don't have to be think, because what happens is in environments like I've worked at, you know, a department store in the past, and you know, it's a lot of it's a combination of men and women personnel, and you know, I don't like to be around women, to be honest, when I'm working. It's sexual tension. I like to, when I'm around women, I like it to be where they're a distance away and I can just look at them and enjoy the visual experience. That's what I think men like. Now that being said, so similar instance here. I, you know, everything went well. I, you know, I was paid at the job with this lady, but I told her I was, you know, hesitant to come back in the future. Not her fault, but just because I was concerned that I had an issue with, you know, managing my own desires, and maybe it could be arranged that she wasn't there when I was doing the work, et cetera, et cetera. You get the idea. And yet another instance, you know, a person that I've known for a while, he, you know, he, you know, he likes me. He's, we've done work on different, you know, we've done, work on different projects together, and he, you know, sometimes he'll say something like he cares about me or loves me. I've told him that that's offensive to me because, you know, we're just, we're friends. You know, I have thousands of friends, and most people do, but we're not spiritual siblings, spiritual brothers or sisters, as it would. You know, we're then so to use the term love, it's not fair, and so I it's not accurate. And so what I told them is, like, do you want me to pretend to like what you're saying? I told them, do you want me to, you know, act like it's okay, and placate and tolerate you? Like, and then following up, I said, do you like having people around you that are more submissive? I encouraged them that it's better to have power people around you, not people that are just dependent upon, you know, you being the authority and telling them what to do. It's good to have self-directed people, you know? And in any case, I told him that, and I think he understood. He tried to, and then he tried to explain to me that, well, you know, it's just, you know, part of my like culture, and it's just my style, and why don't you understand? But really, he's the one direct. It's like whether you're willing to work with people or not, whether you can, and things that cross the line. And for me, that crossed the line. So I said that, you know, we, you know, and instead of he asking me, well, why do you not want people to say that, he just said that, well, you should try and understand why I should say it. And what that is it's changing the subject. The subject, my subject, was, I brought it up, I said, it offends me. And, you know, if he actually, quote unquote, loved me or cared about me, then he would say something like, you know, I'm concerned, I didn't mean to offend you, I'll try not to say, I won't say it again. And and then he, if he was curious, he goes, well, help me understand your view and I'll be sure to respect it. But I'm, you know, we're both mature adults, and so to question, to try to challenge me, it just, you know, that might be cause for me to not work with him anymore. And so you have to weigh your options. There are different types of jobs. Okay, there's some benefits, you know, different types of benefits to jobs. Like there's the benefits of, you know, a nice work environment or other nice coworkers or good pay or rude people or not rude people, you know, level of difficulty of the work, convenience to where you live. Excuse me. There's, you know, opportunity for growth. There's all these odds to weigh. All these elements, and so you must decide individually. Like, is this for me or not? Like, don't just allow individually, you know, events that occur. Don't allow them to don't allow, like, events that occur at any on any given day to affect your overall opinion. Like, don't just try to, you know, tell people, like, oh, you know, I had a bad day, as offensive. Just know in your internally, like, if you really want this job or not, and then do what it takes to keep it. Tolerate who and what. Don't, like, hope people are gonna say sorry or hope the pay is gonna get better. Just know, and don't burn your bridges and whatnot until you, you know, already know that you have other job opportunities. And just the same, like, don't assume you're gonna get paid or there's gonna be money there. Don't spend your money like as if you know nothing's guaranteed, and even a job, they might say, oh, it's gonna be a month's worth of work, but it might not be. I'm trying to see if I think there was one more conversation. Let's see, we had one, two. I mean, basically, it's there was one more. It was kind of along the lines of like, am I being paid fairly? And so that should be discussed openly. You can compare it to other, comparably, paid positions, but it's also a question of level of commitment. Like how much, are you willing to do the job for the company? People will pay more as people are in the year, stay more time with the company, and also their skills that they can offer, and so, and there are other complications, like for example, communicating with coworkers. Like, what if a coworker does something rude to you, and you bring it up, but they are dismissive of it? Like, if you bring it up, will they try to create problems for you? Well, that's why it's important to not get too personal with coworkers. Tell them personal information that they could use against you, or you got to realize when people are different, they'll end up arguing about things. You have to establish, is a person like you in their culture and whatnot. And once you establish that, once you realize that, then you've gotta then decide that, I'm gonna leave this person alone. I'm not gonna over engage with them. I'm not gonna, it's good to take lunch breaks alone sometimes. Be nice to coworkers, but don't like after work, like get too much into it with each other, because and see each other as professionals. Like, be glad that, we're in this same profession and we're doing the same thing, fine, but we have our own lives separate from that. It should be thought of. And I think I've given a lot to consider. Most importantly, in recap, realize that people have sexual desires. So those maybe try to be hidden in the workplace, but they are there, and celebrate it. Celebrate. Okay, great. It's great that people have desires. Now we have to respect one another, keep healthy space, don't harass each other sexually, and don't dress too revealing, especially the women, although they might like to kind of gain the center of attention, some form of power. It should be, and I think, I don't know, I think in like the biological nature, like human females, they kind of have this tendency to want to tease or get everyone's attention, the men's attention, so more men are interested in them. Pretend to like someone. There's certain things that women will do. Maybe act over friendly. So just don't be too friendly. Don't be too emotional. That's really the key issue here. It's don't be too emotional with coworkers, because it's that emotional energy that up and down, the happy, and then you're saying stuff like, "Oh, we're having a great time. Good job, bro. Good, we're like brothers or whatever." And then the next moment, the same people who use these casual, informal, personalizing terms, they end up getting upset at each other because they're expecting too much from each other. They're not actually brothers. They're not actually, best friends, whatever you want to say. They're professionals, and they have to recognize each other's strengths and weaknesses and put them into play accordingly. And not be emotional. Breathe, focus, do the work. And this especially applies to people who have, friends they've known for a while, or say even working with family members, be they legal, biological, or people you really, share the same values with, your spiritual family. Just when you're working, make it work. Be serious about it. And do when you work, work. That's Zen. When you eat, you eat. When you talk, you talk. So when you're working, maybe talking about work. Talking about the company, how it can be better, talking about, the elements of, improving efficiency. Even people do the most basic of things can improve efficiency. By the way, in my future ideal, I see people not being as focused on the money, the income they make, but equally focused on the recognition. Like if they're doing harder work, like being proud, like saying, "Yeah, I did this. I, helped manufacture these cars," or I did XYZ in building or offering services to the community, locally and at large. I did these things, and just the sort of. But no emotion, no being too happy. That's salespeople. They get you in an emotional state, making jokes or compliments or. And then that gets you away from your logical brain. All right. So thank you guys for tuning in, man. It's been a fun little look into the manner of communicating. Dealing with desires in around people, and trying to ultimately be friends. You want to be friends. You want to be able to say hi to them if you see them in public, or perhaps even recommend them if you like their services. Thank you guys. Aloha.